was an introduction. Hello, my name is Tobias Koppers and I work for the Webpack core team. And I'm going to talk about module federation in Webpack 5. So my talk is about module federation in Webpack 5. And I want to tell you about the motivation for this feature, how it works, and how to use it. So the motivation is you have a large to mid-scale application and you work with multiple teams on multiple application paths. So you have separated your application or applications into multiple parts, like microfrontends, but also logical parts. And these parts should be developed independently by different teams. And another requirement is that you have multiple parts sharing common libraries or sharing other parts. Here's an example. You could have a header component and a sidebar component as microfrontend or pages, but you could also have a style guide components library, which is shared by all the applications, but also different things than front ends like data fetching logic, business logic, or other logical components. So let's look at the existing options with Webpack. You could just go with native ECMAScript modules. This way you don't have any build process for linking the path together. You could just consume natively all your modules in the applications and it would use native browser import statements to link them together. But there are some challenges with this approach. You basically opt out of all optimizations Webpack would do for you, like unused explorers, concatenation of modules, or other optimizations. And there are also some challenges about web performance, like you would have each module separately, so it's caused a high count of requests at runtime. Each request has an overhead, and you get less effective compression with more requests, with smaller files, because larger files usually compress better than smaller files. And you have also this drawback about only being able to use ECMAScript modules, and you can't use CommonJS modules, you can't use CSS modules, asserts, or other loader process things like other languages or so in Webpack. There's this option about just doing a single build of all your applications and all its parts together. This way, every module of every other part or application is accessible during the build process, so you can just use them via port statements. But there's also a few challenges with that approach. Each update requires a full build of all applications in all parts, so it has a high build time, and this means high deploy delay from update to deploying the new version of the application. And you also have this problem that you can't separately build each application, so your applications don't stay separate from each other, because if you want to share common parts or common modules or common libraries at runtime, you have to build them together. So it's like a challenge you have to come up with. But there's a plugin in Webpack which allows you to separate a part of your build process into a separate build, which can be built independently. In this scenario, we would build each part as DLL with a so-called DLL plugin. And these DLLs can be consumed at runtime by the consuming build. But you also have a compile time dependency of the DLL generated manifest at compile time. So that's also one challenge. You have to rebuild your application or parts when a part has changed, all consumers have to be rebuilt. And this creates an additional deploy delay. It's not so high compared to the single build approach, but it's still an additional deploy delay you don't want to have. And there's also a big challenge about sharing libraries or sharing common modules. Basically, if multiple parts share a library, you have to pull out or extract this shared library into a separate DLL and separate build process manually, and then consume the DLL generated by the separate process by all parts sharing this library. So it's a lot of manual work involved to be able to share libraries between parts. An alternative to this is externals and building libraries. So each part, in this scenario, each part would be built as library and then consumed by the consuming parts or applications as externals. This eliminates this compile time dependency between the parts and consuming parts, and other modules could be just consumed from the library at runtime. But still, the challenge about sharing libraries stays true for this scenario. Each shared library has to be extracted into a separate build process, separate library, and then be external in each of these consuming parts or consuming applications. So to summarize this, native ECMAScript modules are problematic because of problematic about web performance. A single build process is problematic about build performance, and the DLL and XDEL approach would work, but they require a lot of manual work to extract shared libraries or so on. So in the end, we need a scalable solution, or at least a trade-off, which has good build performance, good web performance, but also a good solution for shared dependencies. That's why we enter module federation. In module federation, you would build each part separately. And here we would build a so-called container, and each part would be published as or deployed as container. And any application or other containers could consume modules from this container. And this relationship, the consumer is the host, and the container would be the remote. And if the host consumes exposed modules from the container, then they would be called remote modules. And so we got back again to the separate, each part is built separately, independently, and deployed independently. So we have this good build performance. You only pay for the build time of your part you're developing or you update it. And the whole process looks like this. Module federation comes with two features or aspects. The first aspect is exposing modules. A container can expose modules, and they can be consumed by the host via remote modules. An exposed module would be an asynchronously exposed. So this means if you request a module from the container, this would be an asynchronous process, and the container would then only load the code related to your exposed modules. This means you only have to pay the cost of the container, the cost for the modules you're really using from the container. So only the code is downloaded from the modules you are using. But as the containers then can still do optimizations like bundling dependencies of exposed modules together, or extracting shared parts of exposed modules automatically. All the optimization Webpack can do for or demand loading is possible for exposed modules. So this brings back the good web performance by minimizing requests, and also only loading what you're really using. So the second aspect is the shared modules aspect. In this aspect, each part or each participant of the application landscape can provide modules or provide shared modules into the share scope. These modules are provided with version information attached. So like the container could expose React in a version 60.3, and it would be put into the share scope. And on the other side, containers or consumers, or every participant of the landscape, can consume modules from the share scope with a version check. So the container maybe asks for React in a version 60.0 or higher, and then it would get the highest version available in the share scope. This way, shared modules can be deduplicated within the share scope by version information, by version tagging, and you don't have to download React twice if you have it as shared module. For shared modules, the same asynchronous loading is there, like with exposed modules. So you would put every shared module in a separate file or separately download, and you only have to download shared modules you are really using. So you can provide all the React versions, but not but if you're only using the newer version, it would not download any old version. So here's an example of this in work. So we start with just this normal application, which has a home page, And on the homepage, there's a login link, and the login link opens a login modal and shows like a button, which like called login or so. And on the homepage, there's a dropdown, which shows something. Everything uses React in this scenario. But the login modal code is loaded asynchronously when clicking on the login button. So it's using on-demand loading for this scenario to move this into a separate chunk, or move it separately downloaded. In this scenario, we have two teams working on this. So team A is working on homepage and the login model, so these components, and team B is working on the component library where this has a drop-down component and also the button component. And this is how it works with a single build. Everything is super optimized, but let's apply module federation on this concept. So from the view of team B, TB only cares about their own components, like the button component and drop-down component, but also their dependencies, like an arrow icon is used for the drop-down, and also the React as library. And to use module federation, TB would flag these modules in their graph, like button is exposed, drop-down is exposed. So exposed means they are available by consumption from the container interface. And also flag React as shared library, so they may be shared with other teams in this at runtime. So now Webpack would create a build, would build a container for all of this. So in this container, there would be a container entry module generated by Webpack, which contain references to all the exposed modules, like button or dropdown. And Webpack would also put every exposed module into a separate file. So like here is button in a separate file, but also dropdown in a separate file, but still be able to bundle dependencies together with a exposing module. So chunking optimization still applies. It would also put every shared module into a separate file because it may be loaded or maybe not loaded, depending on if already a React version is available at runtime. So if you take some examples, like if you request the button component from the container, the runtime would load button chunk, so the file would contain the button, but also the shared modules of this required by this chunk. They would load them in parallel. In the scenario that if there is already a React version, same or higher at runtime available, then request and dropdown would only require their own drop-down chunk, and the React chunk would be loaded from somewhere else or not loaded at all if it's already loaded before. So now let's team A use this container generated by team B. This is how the module graph looks for team A. Team A only cares about their own components, and each component from team B would be added as remote module. So it's only saying there's a container layer somewhere and a consuming dropdown from the container. So from Webpack point of view, there's a remote module, like the dropdown module, and every remote module points to the container as external at runtime. But there's a challenge here, because loading modules from the container is asynchronous. We have to be a bit creative to solve this problem, because if you login module just imports the button component, and importing is usually a synchronous operation. So Webpack will automatically hoist every asynchronous operation required for loading this remote modules up to the next async boundary. An async boundary is like an asynchronous import statement or something like that. So in this case, if you click on the login link, which usually loads the code for the login module, it will in parallel load the code for the button component from the container. So you click the login link, and login module code and button component code would load in parallel, once from the local build, once from the container build. Yeah, and the same happens for shared modules, but it's not in detail explained here. Cool. So now, how can I use it? To use it, there's a module federation plugin available in Webpack 5. And with different properties, you have access to creating container, consuming other containers, but also sharing modules at runtime. Let's look at creating a container. So to create a container, you have to expose modules from the container, which is done by using the exposes property. So the exposes property has some properties like the give each module a public name, like tracking system or data, and a local name, which is like where you the module is on the disk currently from this build. And to each module is supported. It could be just a normal ECMAScript module, could be Common JS module, could be CSS, could be anything processed by loaders, what else. And to consume other containers, you have to use the remotes key or remotes properties in the module federation plugin. And here you give each container a name like analytics and also point to a container location, which is then loaded at runtime. Here it would load the analytics.js script at runtime. To use remote modules from containers, you would just have an import statement with analytics is prefixed with analytics, and then the public name of the module in the container, of the exposed module in the container, here tracking system. Yeah. And to share modules, you have the shared property. And in this shared property, you just list all the modules you want to be able to share between other containers or other applications. Like an example here, React Virtualize is shared, but also React Virtualize, the styles of React Virtualize. And there's also advanced configuration available. Here an example is a React. React must only be ever instantiated once on an HTML page. So you can use a singleton advanced configuration to make sure React is only loaded once. For each shared module, Webpack will figure out which version is provided by looking up the version information from the package.json, but also would look up the required version for each dependency by looking in your package.json in the dependencies list or the dev dependencies list. And yeah, but you could also use more advanced configuration to override this or pass other things or define fallback modules, define different keys. There's also advanced configuration for container building and also for consuming containers available. If you're interested, pause the video and look in the details. At large scale, this could look like this. You have multiple applications which are using component libraries. We are using pages as separate containers, but also business logic is shared or translation stuff or so on. So there's also this funny aspect about orchestration. So now you have built all this container separately, but you have to put them together at runtime. And there are basically two techniques I came up with. The first technique is evergreen. And this means each application always uses the latest published version of a container. In this scenario, if you publish a change to your design systems components, then every application would instantly get the latest version of this at runtime. And there's no additional step between that. It's like having a package.json without log file and running npm install every time you load up the application in the browser. It's a bit risky, but it could work on small scale because your company is in control of all your containers. So if you don't make a mess, it could work for you. But there's also another approach. I called it managed. And in this scenario, application would log the version of the container they are using. And it's like having a package.json with log file. And just like with a log file, there's an active step to upgrade or update the version of your containers which your application is using. So you can validate if this update to your containers works for your application. This is where you can test on application level if containers are still compatible with your applications. And there could be multiple stages like stage and production environment or so on. Here's some ideas how to solve this, but I don't want to go into detail. You can pause the video if you're interested. So to make a summary, module federation allows you to make different builds act as monolithic a monolithic landscape at runtime. Any Webpack supported module is supported, like ECMAScript, CommonJS, but also assets, loader process stuff, or CSS. Sharing modules is available due to semantic versioning at runtime. It's available for all Webpack targets like Web, Node, WebWorker, etc. And you only it will only download the modules you are really using, but it will always use all exports of them. So you have to be aware that there's a trade-off about optimization here. And federated modules are asynchronous, so you need to have an asynchronous loading boundary somewhere in the graph before you're able to use federated modules. So features experimental, so maybe break and trace is coming in future, maybe there are more advanced features in future. Here, I already have some ideas what could come, but don't want to go into detail now. So here are some of the sources you can, if you're interested, look up into the documentation, other talks, and more examples are available online. So I have to say thanks.
But let's go deeper into the topic of the federation. Tobias, can you join me on stage?
Sure. Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, good to have you. I have to say, you're a brave man tackling these issues. So, I don't wear a hat right now, but hats off to you. Awesome that you made it understandable for a person like me who's not into these build systems. We're going to dive into our audience question. And the first one I have is from Albert G. Is there any chance Webpack will make it possible to integrate ES modules as DLLs or convert the Webpack proprietary module system to be compatible with ES modules?
So I think with DLLs, he means containers from the modification or so. So yes, there are plans to make Webpack ECMAScript modules supported. So we can use ECMAScript modules as external. So you can, if you have a container in the ECMAScript format, you would be able to load this container, but we can't produce a container in ECMAScript format. We can't, basically the ECMAScript module format as output format for Webpack is not enabled yet, or we don't have it yet, but we are working on this for Webpack 5, and I think it will be available for the final release, but there are some technical challenges, not about basic JS, that would be straightforward, but if you have combined it with CSS or with complexer stuff, like if you have interop logic in the model like CommonJS and questions about strict mode, like ECMAScript modules are always in strict mode, but CommonJS usually can only opt into strict mode. So we would have some behavior changes to modules. So these are questions we are considering. So it's kind of very difficult to make some feature like this. This comes with other builders like straightforward. But with Webpack, we have a lot of features we have to support if we want to provide something like that. So it's not that easy for us to add this, but we are planning to add this, and we probably add some limitations to that, and so you can't use it with some complexer structures. So we have some workarounds to make it work.
But yeah, it kind of ties into the panel discussion we had before, that you kind of have to, you don't want to be stuck in the past, you want to continue going forward, but yeah, you can't leave everyone behind. So that, of course, slows you guys down, down as well.
I think a lot of value in Webpack is the stability and the backward compatibility for existing code. So we have a lot of large user base, and we don't want to leave them back with newer versions. We want to keep the existing features supported while adding new ones.
Yeah, thank you for that. We're going to go to the next question from Tudor. Are there any benchmarks on bundle size or load time results when using module federation?
So I don't have benchmarks, but Sekjection has a big repo with a lot of examples, and you can play around with a lot of sample cases with module federation. But to summarize it, we want to keep basically Webpack is based on if you load something or load something on demand, it should only take one round trip to the server and download everything and maybe make parallel requests to load all the stuff. And we want to keep this, we keep this limitation or keep this goal for motivation. So it will still take one round trip to the server. But with modular federation, you could lose some optimization ability. So it could increase the code size if you share modules with other. We have to provide all exports of the module. So we don't know which exports are used in the whole application landscape. So we basically prepare all modules to be used by anyone. So we can do less optimization at this boundary between where shared modules or exposed modules come together with other runtime loaded containers or applications, which we don't know at compile time. So
yeah,
it could increase bundle size, but it also could decrease it by sharing ability to share modules between these kind of micro-founded or parts of the application.
So in the short answer, it depends.
It depends. Always the answer.
Yeah, that's always hard, of course. It depends on the landscape of the user. All right.
Always measure.
Yeah, it's always the user. The next question is from Ameya. Is there any way to figure out the affected apps based on updating a container?
Yeah, so it was a process. There's two different approaches in my talk. So evergreen, so you don't get to know when a container changes. But the managed approach is about verifying that the application still works with updated containers. So in this approach, you would actively test your application with the updated containers, make sure everything works, and then deploy the new application specification with new latest version of the container. So this is the way you want to do if you have considerations about stability when containers are updated and so on.
Okay. We have a little bit more time. Let's just take another question. This question is from Kirill. Not sure if I understood. How does containers share between frontends? Are they deployed separately? Also, would loaded modules share state, or there will be execution in isolation? They will be executed in isolation.
So regarding sharing state, so all the modules in all containers will act as monolithic applications. So it will behave like if there was a single build of all your modules. So all modules are basically it's kind of in the same cache, so every module is only instantiated once, and they can share functions. They're not isolated, they're all put together in a common module scope or module thing. So it's you can do everything you can do with normal state sharing. You can put state in your modules and like a store, a Redux store, for example, and all applications, all containers would be able to access this state in this one module exposed or shared. And what was the other part of the question?
How are containers shared between frontends? Are they deployed separately?
Yes. So the easiest way is to deploy every container. So you build every container separately and deploy it to some location, to some URL, and then you would use this URL to reference the container from applications or other containers. So each container can be, and that was the intention of this whole system, deployed separately, and at runtime they will be linked together and act as whole application.
Okay, thank you. Last question we have time for is from Stefan. Can the bundles modules be changed at runtime? For example, if I have 100 A/B tests and want to ship only 5 to my users, which 5 I only know when the user requests my app? Can module federation help me with this?
So yes, you can do this. Could compile two versions of a container and then choose at runtime which container you want to load. So basically you have your A and the B version, and at random or with cookies or whatever, you and at some condition you can, at once you ship the one container and the other case you ship the other container, and the application would use it at runtime. So everything will come together at runtime in the browser of the user. So you can... Mm-hmm. switch everything. It's also possible to dynamically load containers via URL if you want something like that. Like you get a server response, like load this container, and then the runtime would load this could be able to load this one container and load some modules and instantiates and like plugins or something you want to load dynamically.
Okay. Well, I hope everyone has got his questions answered. But for those who didn't, of course, Tobias will be in his own private Zoom room where you can pick his brain on Module Federation or Webpack in general, but trying to keep it on topic. So Tobias, thanks a lot for this amazing talk. I'm looking forward to diving deeper into Module Federation.
Thanks for having me.